Hey there everybody, Scotia here with a very fun video for today because after what has felt like a very long couple of weeks, we have finally had our first look at gameplay for Mortal Kombat 1, and it just looks incredible. So I'll go into more depth, you know, later on and throughout the video on certain things, but yeah, honestly, I just was completely blown away by this gameplay trailer and the little bit of the presentation we had afterwards at Summer Game Fest the other day. And yeah, like, it just, everything just looks so good. I honestly... You know, when the game was first revealed, and you obviously, like, you know, we've had a few more combat games by now, especially by NetherRealm, we know what the score is. But even then, I was just really just blown away by a lot of what I was seeing. And of course, I'll go into more detail, as I said. But yeah, just incredible showing, incredible trailer. My hype for this game is just through the roof right now. So yeah, without further ado, let's just kind of go through the trailer and just go through, you know, the parts that stood out or the parts that I have something to say about. And yeah, that's pretty much it, really. So just let's just get right into it. So the beginning of the trailer I don't have too much to say about because it is mostly just a fight between Sub-Zero, Scorpion, Kung Lao and Raiden. And yeah, like there's not much really here. We do get a first look at the gameplay. And one thing I will say is I do like that the camera seems a bit more zoomed out now and is a bit, you know, the character's obviously still in their place, but like it's a bit more zoomed out and it feels like there's more like room at the top. And I feel like that's been done to like highlight the stages. And I will talk about the stages as we go through them. Because for the most part, they are fucking incredible. Like, they are so, like, I'll just get into it now, I guess. These are some of the best stages I have ever seen in a fighting game, like, in all honesty. The Johnny Cage stage, which I'll get to in a minute, genuinely is one of the best stages I've ever seen in my life. Like, it is incredible. But the other stages throughout this trailer, some are better than others, obviously. Like, the ones we see during this opening part with Sub-Zero, Scorpion, Kung Lao, and Raiden is good, but, like, just some of the other stages coming up in this trailer are just so insane. The gorgeous and like the colors and the vibrancy and just what's going on. But yeah, I think the camera being so kind of like zoomed out, not like a ton, but like it zoomed out for, you know, with Gap at the top now. And I feel like that's been done as well for air combos because we've seen in the footage there's quite a lot of air combos, and you know, with the cameos, you know, combos are definitely going to be taking place in the air a bit more often, at least from how they were in 11. So, you know, that makes sense. So I think it's that reason as well as the reason like to kind of let the stages breathe a bit. But I think that's a really good choice. But yeah, other than that, nothing much really to say during this part. We see the characters that we've already seen from the CG trailer. I still think Sub-Zero so far has the best design. Out of the majority of the characters, there is one design I think that is as good, if not better. But I will get to that design when we eventually get to it. But yeah, just, you know, just a really cool, you know, opening montage fight. What's interesting is that the way this ends is that it seems like this is when Liu Kang, you know, meets Raiden and Kung Lao and, like, recruits them to his side. And that's very interesting because I thought Raiden and Kung Lao would have already, you know, been on Liu Kang's side from the start. The trailer made it, like, seem that way at least. But for all intents and purposes, at least how this trailer frames it, it very much seems like Scorpion and Sub-Zero are already on Liu Kang's side. They've already been recruited and are, you know, part of his cause. Another very interesting thing is that when Ed Boon talked to Jeff Keighley after, you know, the trailer played on stage at Summer Games Fest, he was kind of like going over some info and, like, you know, dropping little bits here and there about how the story was different. And he said that Sub-Zero and Scorpion are actually brothers. And I'm not entirely sure about this yet because Ed said that they were brothers, but then I've seen other, like, stuff that apparently saying that they might be blood brothers, so, you know, might not be biologically related. I don't know. I'm not against the idea of them being brothers. I think it's very interesting, but it's like, at this point, someone's getting left out, because with Scorpion and Sub-Zero, it's, you've got Bi-Han, Kuai Liang, and Hanzo. And for them to be brothers, like, one of those three basically has to be left out. And I'm still, you know, hardcore going, like, on the basis that Sub-Zero at the moment in this game is Bi-Han, the elder Sub-Zero who, you know, who was noob in the original games. Like, that's still my bet. I still think this is Bi-Han, just the fact that, you know, he just seems older, seems more, not mature, but just seems a bit sterner, a bit colder, no pun intended. Whereas Scorpion seems very, you know, he seems like the younger of the two. He's very, you know, there's a scene later on when Liu Kang is talking to the both of them and, like, Scorpion, like, bows and quickly runs away when Liu Kang, like, says something to them. But Sub-Zero just stays there and he stays with Liu Kang. So it's like, it feels like there's very much a rank of superiority where Sub-Zero is, you know, above Scorpion. So that's interesting. If it's Bi-Han and Hanzo, then that's, you know, there is that bit of confusion then, I guess, because it's like Bi-Han and Kuai Liang were Chinese in the original games and Hanzo was Japanese. So if Hanzo is the younger brother and still Scorpion, which, to be honest, he should be, you know, I've heard some people say, like, oh, what if Kuai Liang is Scorpion, and I just that's just too weird for me personally. And I also just don't see them getting rid of Hanzo like that. But it is interesting, you know. It would make more sense, I guess, if they were blood brothers and not actual brothers. But it's very interesting nonetheless. But we'll have to see where it goes from that. After this, we then get the reveal of Johnny Cage and, to my absolute shock, Kenshi. And Kenshi was always a character I thought had a decent chance. Like, he wasn't an X. He's always been the most popular character from the 3D era of the series, hands down, no contest. And nobody can argue against that. You know, like Kenshi being the most popular on the most successful of the 3D era, you know, characters that were introduced in that era. Like, that's an absolute fact. Like, nobody can argue against that. So it's not too surprising that he's here, but like, I don't know, like, there's been a lot of leaks in the last couple of weeks and rumors and stuff like that. Like, oh, like, this leaker said this and this rumor said that, and like, here's like a partial roster. And like, Kenshi wasn't in like any of them, which is really surprising. And like, the fact he's like so like prominently here, like, I would say more than anything, like, this is like Kenshi's trailer, honestly. Like, he by far, I think, I don't know if he has the most appearances, but like, he's in a lot of scenes. We see him in like three different costumes throughout this trailer, which is really, you know, weird. I don't know if we ever really had that in a trailer where like we've seen so many variations of this like one character. But yeah, he looks great. One thing that I kind of like, I don't think it's a bad thing, but one thing is like, every time I see him, like, he looks so much like Louis Tan, who plays Cole Young in the MK movie that came out a couple years ago. And like, I know some people are like wretched the thought of like Cole Young and all that. I haven't seen the MK movie because I just don't really get a chance to go to the theaters or cinemas or watch movies that much anymore. So I have no judgment on the guy or anything. He seems pretty boring, but you know, I can't fully judge him because I haven't seen the movie and seen his role in that game. But no, like, that aside, I actually really like how Kenshi looks in this. Very interesting is that he pretty much appears to be a member of the Yakuza, which is very interesting because there's some shots. You see it better in the shot that played when... there's actually two shots. It's one when he's in his Shaolin gear. You see the tattoos on his hands, and when he's in the Clash interaction dialogue with Sub-Zero in the gameplay they played after the trailer with Ed Boon. You see him there, and he has tattoos on his hands. So the implication is that, like, you know, he's got the typical kind of, like, Yakuza tattoos that go all the way up over his body and his arms and all that. Really cool choice. Like, I'm not totally against the idea of it, because it is a pretty significant change. Like, Kenshi was always just, you know, he was just Kenshi. He was just this kind of like cocky fighter. And then he got tricked by Shang Tsung, lost his eyes, blah, blah, blah. And then he just, you know, became noble and all that. But for him to be, you know, be a member of the Yakuza is very interesting. I think, you know, I'm very intrigued in seeing where that goes. There was like a press release of sorts that I saw on Gamatsu that kind of like went into like, you know, very general, like, oh, you know, my Mortal Kombat 1, blah, 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 latest entry in the series. But it like had like a brief bit about the characters. And for Kenshi's, it was like basically Kenshi has, you know, took it upon himself to go on a quest to retrieve Sento, his, you know, his family's sword, which was, you know, his story from the previous games. But Sento is actually now in the possession of Johnny Cage, and that's why that's what we see in the trailer, like him going to Johnny Cage's mansion in the hills and trying to steal it back. But also mentions it's like to restore honor to his family or something like that. So like, I'm wondering if family is the Yakuza family, you know. Also very interesting thing is like, obviously, because we know from the Amazon leak, Takeda is going to be DLC, obviously, in MKX. Takeda was Kenshi's son. Obviously, Kenshi looks pretty young now, so I didn't really know how that was going to work. I was always thinking like, oh, maybe it was Takeda from like a different timeline or the original timeline. I'm actually wondering now if Takeda is going to be sort of like the younger, kind of like the younger brother of sorts. Like, I believe the term is like Aniki, but Aniki is for like the older brother. So like, Kenshi would be Takeda's Aniki because it's like, you know, big brother. I think for Kenshi to Takeda, it would be like maybe Kyodai or something like that. I'm trying to like use the best of my Yakuza knowledge from the series, the Like a Dragon series, like, because I've played those games to death. I love them. So I'm just trying to think of the wordage, but because it's been a while since I played through them all, been about probably well over a year. So yeah, but no, I think that might be what they might do with Takeda. Like, you know, instead of him being his son, Takeda might be, you know, the junior, and Kenshi's like the older brother, kind of, sort of like the Aniki, the big brother who's looking after and like mentoring the younger Takeda. I don't know, I think that'd be cool if it was done like that. I'm not necessarily against the idea of them being father and son again. It just seems like with the way Kenshi looks, like he looks pretty young, like I said, and also the fact like we see him pretty much throughout this trailer, like, you know, still having the use of his eyes, he's not blind yet. But yeah, like, we know he still looks like typical Kenshi and that he will probably at some point in the story lose his eyes again. So, you know, but that, you know, it just seems a bit weird, like, for Takeda to be playable. But then again, maybe it's the Takeda, you know, he's still Kenshi's son, but it's the Takeda from a different universe. At the moment, I do like my idea of him, you know, being a kind of, like, junior member of their Yakuza clan, who Kenshi is the big brother of and is, you know, mentoring and all that. I think that'd be really cool. I hope that's the case, but yeah. But, yes, yeah, so that's Kenshi. Like, really, really cool. Really surprised me. Did not expect him to be revealed. I mean, I guess at all. Like, I knew he was possible, but, you know, I definitely didn't expect him so soon, like, because to be fair, he is the first 3D era character that we've had revealed before a lot of other characters, before a lot of other iconic characters. So I think that's really cool. I'm glad a 3D era character, even if it is, like, you know, the primo token 3D era character. You know, I'm glad they're getting, you know, the bit more of a push before other more, you know, prominent characters. I think that's cool, and I am a fan of that. But yeah, anyway, so going back to this scene, so basically Kenshi and Johnny Cage are like fighting in Johnny's mansion, and this is the stage I was talking about earlier. This stage looks incredible. Like, I can't get over how good it looks. It just looks so fantastic. But during this fight and this gameplay, we get our first look at the cameo system, and now that we know what it finally is, I was kind of sort of right in my predictions, where it was like I thought it was basically going to sort of be like a more kind of like deeper type of system that was used in MK11, which was, I believe, was called the, the consumables, I think it was, where it was like, in MK11, when you did a tower, you could, like, throw, like, a Cyrax bomb in the middle of the arena, but, like, it was Cyrax, but you didn't see Cyrax, you just saw the bomb, and then the bomb would go off, like, as the move does for Cyrax, but then that would be it, and, like, you wouldn't see anything else, but, like, you could use that move, you know, once it's, like, cooled down and all that. And my theory was that it was basically going to work like that, but like in this instance for cameos, like you get the Cyrax bomb, but like you would actually physically see Cyrax. He would jump into the match, do the move, and then disappear. And in some ways, it is very much like that, but there is definitely a lot more to it, in the sense that like there's definitely a lot more freedom to it. I thought it was literally just going to be like they jump in, do the move, jump out, but you actually see them, and like, oh, that's cool. Like we get to see these characters, even if they're not playable, kind of like a, you know, kind of like a silver lining, like, oh, you know, we couldn't get Movado playable, but at least, you know, he's a cameo, and we know we can see him in, you know, modern graphics and stuff like that. That's how I thought it was going to work, but, like, no, like, some of the stuff they were showing was, like, literally just at any point in a combo, in the middle of a throw, a move, a special move, anything, like, that you can really use them at any point. Like, obviously, there is a cooldown, which is fair, but, like, if they're not on a cooldown, like, you can literally just use them at any point in the match. And, you know, and they'll do something specific, like this one where I saw where someone grabs Sub-Zero in the middle, like, to do a throw. And in the middle of the throw, you know, Kano, like, MK1 Kano comes out and, like, attacks him and, you know, has his own little cinematic kind of, like, zoomed in, you know, throw attack that, you know, happened because he did the cameo in the middle of the throw. And, you know, there's other stuff they showed where, like, cameos, you know, you can have a joint, like, X-ray fatal blow with your like specific cameo, and like it seems like it'll be different like depending on which cameo you do. Like in the part in this trailer, Kenshi is with Classic Sub-Zero, and like Kenshi does his move like afterwards, where like, he does his, you know, with the spirit and the sword and he stabs them. But, like before that, like Sub-Zero does his sliding and like smashes the skull, and, you know, it very much seems like there's going to be a lot of like kind of like mixing and matching. Like I definitely think you're going to be like, oh, if you use Kenshi with like the Goro cameo, like, oh, that's going to be like a very good way, like that's going to be a very strong kind of like assist. And they even show later on that they like some of these cameos, or maybe not some, I assume all of them, but like these cameos have like fatalities as well, which is really cool. I was not expecting that level to it. So yeah, I'm very impressed with the cameos. I think they're going to be really fun. I can't wait to see what types of characters they add. My main wish is that like I hope it's not just like Classic, like it's just like, oh, here's the characters that are also playable. Like, oh, here's Sub-Zero with, like, you know, his MK1 design. But then as the cameo, he just gets, like, Classic Sub-Zero. And, like, I don't want that to be the thing for everybody. Like, I don't want, like, you know, obviously we've seen, like, Classic Sonya, Classic Kano, and Classic Jax. Like, they're at the moment only confirmed as cameos. They're probably going to be playable because it's, you know, those three have literally been in every game since, I think, Armageddon. Like, they've been in every NRS game. They're probably not going to skip it here as much as I would like them to, just for the sake of, you know, mixing things up in variety. But, like, I hope the roster basically isn't just like, oh, you know, here's, because there's only like 16 cameo slots, you know, based off the character select. So it's like, you got 16 cameo slots and like four of them are only going to be like characters that actually aren't in the game. You know, maybe people would prefer that. Maybe people are like, oh, you know, I don't want a character only locked behind a cameo. And I completely understand that. But to me, it's like, I don't know, I just think it'd be lamer if the cameos were literally just like classic versions of characters. You know, like classic Scorpion, Sub-Zero, classic Sonya, classic Jax, classic this guy, classic this woman. That would be really lame to me because it would just be like, I don't know, it just feels wasted in that sense. Like, because there's going to be characters that, like, are not going to be playable. I said this in the previous video I did about MK1, about the Amazon leak, where it was like, Mavado, he was never coming back. Like, we are never getting Mavado playable in a game ever again, because there's just no demand for him. Like, maybe that gets better if he's a really sick cameo, because we know, obviously, he's going to be a cameo in the combat pack. You know, maybe he's really cool and people demand it, but, like, at the moment, Mavado was never going to make it. He was never going to be playable. There was a dozen other 3D era characters that were going to get in before them, but it's really cool that he's going to be a cameo, and it's going to be really cool to see him in this engine, because to me, it's like, they're either a cameo or they're just not in the game at all, and at this point, I would rather a character be a cameo and actually physically appear and I can see them again, than just them be completely ignored and forgotten again. Like, I really, really want Kai playable. Like, at this point, outside of Ermac and, like, you know, Smoke probably, it's like, Kai is probably one of my most wanted characters. I have no expectations of him making it. I know he won't be playable because there's just no demand there. It's the same with Mavado, but probably not as worse, where it's like, I would love Kai, but I know he's not going to be playable, so I would love it if Kai was a cameo. Like, yeah, I would much prefer him playable, but if it's literally the difference between this character physically being in the game for the first time since, like, Armageddon, or just not appearing again for, like, the fucking 8th game in a row or whatever it is. Like, yeah, hell yeah, I would take a cameo. Like, to me, that's much more, like, preferable than just not getting Kai, but, like, oh, look, we've got Sonya in the game in a classic, like, MK1 outfit. And then that's just the cameos. Like, that's the type of cameos we get. But yeah, that's basically my stance on it, you know. We have seen, obviously, I mentioned Goro earlier, and we got confirmation that the one that turns up in the Melina and the Katana segment was indeed Goro. And, you know, he had a different design. He just didn't have his classic, you know, MK1 look or anything like that. So, you know, at least we know that, like, these cameos might have unique designs and stuff like that. I mean, we did see as well that Sonya has actually two skins. We've seen for her. She has her MK1 design and she has her MK3 design, so, you know, that's a good sign. Maybe, you know, maybe each cameo will get their own, like, unique design. It's like, oh, here's the classic skin, but then it's like an alternate skin you can unlock. Maybe you can have, like, oh, here's what they would have looked like if they were in the game. I don't know, just it's just a theory at this point. It happens later on, but I'll mention it now that I'm on the topic of cameos. But easily one of my favorite parts of this trailer was when Stryker showed up. That was really, really cool, because that's another character that probably wasn't going to come back, as much as, you know, Stryker is a part of that, you know, that, you know, the legendary MK1 to 3 roster, like, those characters. Obviously some more than others, but, like, the MK1 to 3 cast are by far and away, like, the most popular in the series. They will always get priority over characters that came after them, like MK4 onwards, basically. So, you know, like, even though Stryker is part of that group, he is, like, probably right at the bottom. Like, if there is any character that is, like, you know, MK4 and onwards tier in terms of, like, this character's probably not coming back. Stryker is that character, as much as, you know, I genuinely liked him in MK9. I thought that version of Stryker was really cool and, like, was a great redemption for that character. And I would love to see them again, but, like, obviously, it's just probably not going to happen. But you know what? Again, cameo is great because we get to see him. It was a great moment. Lots of people had great reactions to it. I was in a Discord talking to people at the time, and we all lost it when Stryker showed up, because it was just amazing to see. Like, you never thought you would have seen it like that, but it's really cool. And, you know, again, that was just a really nice moment, and I'm, you know, that's kind of like the perfect example of what I'm talking about, where it's like, the alternative was that Stryker, we would never see Stryker in this game ever, like, you know, even beyond this game. Like, it's just either he's a cameo and he appears and we get a great moment where it's like, oh shit, Stryker's back, even though he's a cameo, or we get this thing of like, oh, you know, Stryker's just gone. And it's like, even to us, it's like, they're basically a character even if they're not physically playable. It's like, he's got fatalities, he's got fatal blows, he's got moves. Like, we'll see him in the character select and we'll see him in intros and stuff like that and outros. It's not like, would I like him playable more? Yeah, sure, but, like, it's not like the cameos are just one and done consumables like they were in 11. It's like, no, they will actually have a presence throughout the match, and, like, I think that's great. Like, I genuinely can't wait to see, like, Mavado. Like, I was talking about him earlier. Like, I can't wait to see Mavado and just see him in the game and in, like, the character select and in cutscenes. Well, not cutscenes, but, like, in the character select, in the outros, the intros, the fatalities, the crushing blows, the fatal blows, whatever it is, the x-rays. But yeah, like, I don't know, that's just my stance on it, really. I do like the system a lot, and even though, you know, it may not end up being my favorite thing gameplay-wise, I just think the idea behind it and the opportunity it gives to characters that we're probably not going to get in the game anyway. I don't know, I think it's great. So we then get to this part of the trailer where we see Kenshi and Raiden in like these, you know, bright orange Shaolin, like White Lotus uniforms, and they have a segment where they fight. Again, this stage is gorgeous, just absolutely killing it on the stages. These stages so far have all just been absolutely amazing. I'm so blown away by almost all of them. One thing I want to talk about, and this was kind of like what I was talking about earlier, was like there was a design in this trailer that I liked almost as much as Sub-Zero's, if not as much as Sub-Zero's. And this is Kenshi's here. I think that he looks great in this costume. I will absolutely be using this costume a lot. And, you know, I think it's really cool that, like, in this trailer, we actually get to see kind of like the progression, or we at least get an idea of the progression of Kenshi in this game, of going from, like, Yakuza, trying to bring back honor to his family. He ends up getting roped into what's going on with, you know, Liu Kang and that, and then he gets recruited by Liu Kang and joins that group, the hero group with Johnny and Raiden and Liu Kang and blah blah blah. And then, you know, he obviously, by the looks of it, will probably renounce his, you know, criminal Yakuza ways and then become a member of the White Lotus. I think that's sick. You know, I think that's really, really cool. And obviously it's a really cool costume for Raiden as well. But I don't know, I feel like the way Kenshi's looks and with the sword and all that, I just really like it. I think it looks really cool. We then get the Katana and Melina segment of the trailer, and, like, you know what, I'm nothing against those characters and the fans of those characters, but, like, I just don't really care about either of them. They're cool, and I'm glad, you know, they're in the game and all that, and they both look great, and the stages, again, look great. I really like the Living Forest type redux where it's not so evil anymore, it's just like a peaceful living forest. That's really cool. But yeah, just don't really have a lot to say about these two in general. Like, they're cool, like, they're okay, they're not my favorite characters, and they never will be, but you know what, they look great, and that's probably the best you can ask for, really. We then get other stuff as well, like, again, the stage with the fireworks is just, it's just gorgeous to look at. And then we get to the end of the trailer where we get the reveal that fatalities can be done by cameos as well, and you can also get the team-up Fatal Blow cameos as well. And yeah, and it ends with the classic, you know, Sub-Zero fatality with the cameo. Yeah, and then that's pretty much the trailer, really. I mean, I've already talked about most of it. I was going through the trailer in my head. I didn't realize I'd already kind of, like, caught up that much. But yeah, that's the trailer. But just, man, what a hell of a showing. It absolutely blew me away. I was just so overjoyed watching all of it, and, like, I'm just so excited. In some ways, like, this is, like, completely, like, stolen the thunder from Street Fighter 6 for me. And, like, I don't want to do, like, a versus thing. Like, I'm already sick of seeing, like, you know, I'm not going to single them out as, like, Capcom fans or Street Fighter fans or anything like that, but, like, just people in the FGC who clearly aren't that interested in, you know, NRS games and MK. And that's fair, they don't have to be. I'm not saying everybody has to like it, but, like, I don't know, I've seen so much already, like, people just mocking NetherRealm and, like, oh, you know, the bad animations and stuff like that, and, like, I've seen people say the game looks worse, and, like, I don't know, but I think we're at the point now with consoles and, you know, generations and graphics where it's, like, we're not going to get big generational leaps anymore, like, at least not to the level that we've had in the past. Like, MKX to Injustice 2 was insane. When they first showed Injustice 2 gameplay, that was probably the moment for me where I was like, this is next gen. Like, this is absolutely the next level. And, like, would I like something like that again? Sure, but to be honest, after MK11, like, how do we top that? Like, how do we get even better than that? You know, we just can't. Like, we can't get to that level again. Like, we're not getting a big jump like that. Like, we kind of, like, I feel like this, and this is obviously a bigger topic about gaming as a whole, but, like, I feel like we've just plateaued when it comes to, you know, graphics and stuff like that. And it's like, we're just not going to get big generational leaps anymore. Like, I just don't know what people were really expecting. Like, to me, this looks as good, if not better than MK11, but not in, like, a graphical sense. Like, I think the art style looks better. I think the stages absolutely look better. Like, that's not even a question. Like, you want to look at MK11 stages. I thought most of MK11 stages were honestly not that great. I thought most of the ones in X and 9 were far better. You know, not to say that the ones in 11 were bad, but, like, they just were not that good. Like, but these just absolutely blow them out of the water. Like, it's not even close. I think the character designs are better. Like, personally speaking, I was not a fan of how Sub-Zero and Scorpion, like, their default designs in MK11 looked. I almost always used their alternate costumes more. But I love how Scorpion and Sub-Zero look in this game. So far, like, I love how Kenshi looks. Like, all three of the costumes we see of him in this trailer look fantastic. Like, Raiden looks great. Like, I'm so glad we're actually doing something new with Raiden and moving away from, like, you know, the old guy and stuff like that. And also, as well, I'm glad we're getting new voice actors. Like, I've kind of hated Steve Blum, like, voicing Sub-Zero. Not for a while, but, like, definitely in MK11. it just really stood out when you had, like, you know, I can't remember his name, but the guy that voiced Scorpion in MK11, who did a fantastic job. Like, it's a shame he's not back, but I see why he's not back, because he did a really good older Scorpion. But he had him, and he sounded way more authentic, and obviously Japanese, because the guy voicing him, I believe, was also Japanese. And then you had, like, Steve Blum voicing, like, a Chinese ninja with the most generic American accent. Like, it's a cool voice, but, like, when you're kind of, like, focusing and honing in on more, like, the Chinese aspect of the Lin Kuei and, like, Kuai Liang and that they were doing in MK11, like, and then just the voice is just so completely, like, different, it just really rubbed me the wrong way. So I'm glad, you know, we've got a new voice actor for Sub-Zero. I'm absolutely glad we got a new voice actor for Raiden. You know, nothing personal against Richard Epcar, but, like, I've just not been a fan of him as a voice actor for a very long time. I am also hoping he's not doing Akuma in Street Fighter 6 again. He probably is, but it's whatever. But, like, yeah, really glad Raiden's doing something different, you know, with the voice and the design. I think that's great. Yeah, like, I don't know. I just think everything that this game is doing is just, it's hitting the notes for me way more than MK11, like, ever did, really. And I really like MK11. Like, I had a lot of fun with that game. I played it a lot. I had a lot of fun, you know, in the build-up to the release and the coverage and all that. But just so far, like, this game, it just really just seemed, like, all the things it's doing and showing and telling me, it's just really, you know, it's hitting me in places that, like, MK11 never really did. And for that, I'm, you know, I'm just overjoyed. Like, I can't wait to see more of this game. I can't wait to see, like, the other characters. Can't wait to see the cameos. I just can't wait to see more. Even stages. Like, I can't wait to see more stages. I want to see how these stages look. Like, I want, like, in more detail in the actual matches. Like, I want to see, like, the other stages we're going to get. Like, I just can't wait, man. Like, everything about this game at the moment just excites me. Everything that they're showing excites me. Everything that they could show in the future, in the next, you know, 14 weeks before the game comes out, it all just excites me. And, you know, that's just great. But yeah, like, I actually completely forgot, because I was talking about Street Fighter 6 earlier. Yeah, and it's like, I'm enjoying Street Fighter 6, and, like, you know, I had fun with it, and I've been doing videos on it if you've been catching up on the channel. But, like, I don't know, I feel like Street Fighter 6 to me is in this really weird place where the game is great, but, like, the roster to me is just so disappointing. And the fact it's, like, I'm like, now, this moment, I know that, like, even a year from now, Street Fighter 6's roster won't be any better. Like, I'll have Ed, and that's great, and I'm excited for Ed, but Ed wasn't a character I really wanted at the time. Like, I'm glad he's in, and I did want Ed eventually, but, like, there's a lot more characters I wanted before Ed, and, you know, a year from now, they're still not going to be added. We'll have no idea what Season 2 is doing. So in that sense, it's like Street Fighter 6 to me, it's like, it's hit the level I feel like at the moment it's only going to get for me, where it's like, the game is great, and I enjoy playing it, and I'm having fun playing his characters like Manon and Marissa and stuff like that. But, like, that's it. Like, that's the highest that game's going to get for me at the moment until it starts actually adding characters I wanted. Whereas, you know, yes, I know MK1 already having Ermac basically confirmed from the Amazon League, that helps a lot. But, like, I'm just so more, like, just Sub-Zero and Scorpion and, like, Johnny and Kenshi. Like, it's just, this game already has so much more that excites me. It already has so much more that, like, is kind of, like, catered to me. And I don't want to sound selfish or anything like that, but, like, when you look at a game, like, you kind of have to look at it as, like, how does this game cater to me? Because that should be the job of a game, I feel like, especially fighting game with the rosters. It's like, you should be catering to as many people as possible. Like, you're not going to fit everyone in, you're not going to please everyone, that's just, you know, reality. But, like, for me, Street Fighter 6 made no attempt to cater to as many people as possible. It catered to the Street Fighter 2 fans, it catered to the Jury fans, but, like, that's it. It didn't, you know, it completely ignored the Street Fighter 3 fans, which, as you may know, I'm a big Street Fighter 3 fan, more than any other fighting game on this planet. Street Fighter 3 Third Strike means more to me than most other games will ever do, and that roster is a very big part of that. Alpha fans, I'm a big fan of Alpha 2. You know, not as much as Street Fighter 3, but, like, it's definitely up there for me. You know, Alpha fans completely ignored and stuff like that, where it's like, whereas I feel like, you know, just having stuff like Kenshi again, and, like, there are rumors as well that, like, MK1 is going to be, you know, introducing more, bringing back more 3D era characters. There is already a pretty good leak or rumor going around at the moment that Li Mei is the character that might get revealed soon, and that's crazy to me. Like, Li Mei is a character I genuinely never thought we'd see again, and, like, Street Fighter 6 at the moment has nothing like that. There is no character in Street Fighter 6 that I'm like, I cannot believe this character is back. And at the moment, that's going to be the case for Street Fighter 6 for, like, another year at least. And, like, that to me is that thing where it's like, Street Fighter 6 is fun, it's a great game, I will play it for many years, but, like, that enjoyment I get from the game, like, I've already hit that ceiling. Like, I finished World Tour, I've unlocked all the arcade artwork, there's nothing more for me to really get out of that game outside of just playing characters that like are fun but not who I wanted. And whereas MK1 is like already, it's just hitting the notes for me that I wanted it to, like that I would get the most out of. And like to me, that's just a big difference. And I think that just really helps a lot with the overall interest and the overall excitement and stuff like that. But yeah, I don't want to pit the games against each other. They're both fantastic games. I know this is going to be an amazing game. Street Fighter 6 is already an amazing game that will get better. But as of right now, 100%, I am far more excited for MK1 than I am for Street Fighter 6 at any point, really. This game will absolutely blow me away when I eventually get around to playing it, and I can't wait to play it. But yeah, it's just a shame for Street Fighter 6, I guess. But like, in some ways, since this trailer came out, like I've been trying to play Street Fighter 6, and like, I can play it and I get enjoyment from it. But the whole time, I'm just like, man, like MK1, I can't wait to play MK1. I want to see more characters. I want to see Reptile. I want to see Li Mei. I want to see these other characters that are just going to be sick when they eventually get revealed. And yeah, and you know what? I'm fine with that. I'm happy with that. You know, Street Fighter 6 will do me for now. But once it gets to September, like, man, I'm going all in on MK1. But yeah, I'm going to leave things here. I definitely did not expect this video to be as long as it did. But you know what? I say that every time and I always end up going long. And as you can no doubt tell, or maybe you can't, I don't know. But my voice is getting a bit rough here. So yeah, I'm going to leave it here. Like I said, fantastic trailer. Cannot wait. NRS just continue to just deliver pretty much every time they really do something like this, a big reveal like this. Can't wait to start, you know, covering the game in more depth. The last couple of weeks sucked, to be honest. Like, as much as, you know, it did kind of go quick in some ways. I'm just so glad we're like now at the start where it's like the marketing started. Like, I've already been seeing matches from people playing it at Summer Games Fest in the last couple of hours. So yeah, just sick stuff all around, man. I can't wait. This just, what a fucking trailer. It just completely blew me away. But yeah, with that all out of the way, I'm gonna leave things here. Thank you all for watching, and I shall see you all in the next video. Thank you so much. Goodbye.
We await your return, warrior.